Luke writes, a crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native tongue of each. We got kind of a feel for that this morning with the various languages that were shared, quoting John 3:16. But even with that visual aid this morning, can we really even begin to imagine what that first Pentecost must have been like on that day when the church was born? I think sometimes when we celebrate great days like this in the life of the church, after a while, those holidays and the meaning behind them tends to lose its punch just a bit. After all, what can a pastor say about the events and the meanings of Easter and Christmas that has not been said already? Each year at this time, we hear this story of the tongues of fire resting on the heads of the disciples in that upper room. Each year we hear how those folks broke out of that room, that place where they had been hiding, encapsulated, imprisoned by the fear that surrounded them, and took the word to the streets. And everyone could understand what they were saying. Foreign visitors in Jerusalem for the day of Pentecost, they heard the native tongue being spoken, and it must have been incredible. Can we get a feel for that? It seems that as the years go by and as the words of the story become familiar to us, they tend to lose a bit of their power for us. Friends, there's no time like the present to get that power back, that spark, that tingle of the power of the Spirit back again, because the core of this passage and the passage that Jen read from the Old Testament this morning is getting the news out there so that people can hear it. That news that Jesus is alive. The news that the power of God's love is greater than any force this world has ever seen. The message is pretty simple when you think about it. When folks join the church, we don't ask them to recite complicated and deep creeds or doctrinal statements. What do we ask of recent confirmands that are here? What's the question we asked you when you joined the church? Who is your Lord and Savior? We ask them, and the answer is, Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. And claiming that, professing that, confessing that publicly, opens their lives to God's love in ways that they've never experienced before. Opens up God's plan in ways that they've not experienced before. And we celebrate when that happens. And that's good. It's exciting. Whenever young people reach that age where they make their faith their own, you know you've done something right. You have upheld your part of the baptism covenant, and you've seen to it that there's been a Sunday school program, that there have been activities for our youngsters to grow and mature in their faith, and you should feel good about that, because that's what we're about. But anytime someone makes their faith their own, then it's time for us to show them the door. It's time for them to be told, get out of here. You've helped them find their faith voice. Now you're invited to walk with them as they share that faith with that voice out there in the world. Because it's not now as much important about what happens in here. It's what happens in their lives out there as they share that faith, as you share that faith that God has given to you. And don't be shocked and upset if the faith that others share that you've encouraged them to embrace sometimes does not sound the same as the voice you followed or that faith that is coming out of your mouth, because each generation has a new way of communicating that faith, ways of sharing those things that are important to them. I think what surprised the crowds who heard the disciples speaking about God's love in other languages is that they've gotten used to only hearing those words in certain languages, those official languages of the faith. And now they heard the words of God in ways that they could understand, ways that they could apply to their lives, ways that they could live out in their life each day. And that's exciting stuff, because we live in a time when people are searching for ways of expressing and sharing the things that are important to them, especially their faith. I don't believe it's a coincidence that this time of searching and exploring comes at precisely the time that there are more ways of sharing information than ever before. When people are looking for spiritual depth in their lives, there are so many different avenues that they can go to have that search fulfilled. We have cell phones, the internet, ways of sharing pictures and audio and video, and God can pour out His Spirit through them all. We have ways of talking about our faith that are just as wide-ranging. Some folks are vocal and forward with their faith. Others are bashful and retiring. But the same Spirit moves in each one of us, giving us all the message to share. And it's so important that we all recognize all those various ways that the message is getting out. The reading Jen shared from the Old Testament is a reminder of how important it is for us to be open and flexible when it comes to our recognizing the Spirit at work. In Numbers, there's that story about how God's Spirit touched 70 elders under Moses as a part of this elaborate public ceremony. And each one of those elders came into the tent, and as they responded to that Spirit that rested upon them, they had a one-time prophetic opportunity to share what God was speaking to them. And then, as the scripture says, they prophesied no more. One time, and that was it, so you better get it right. But what's fascinating about the passage is the two guys on the outside, two guys who didn't make it into the tent, Medad and Eldad, were also touched by God's Spirit. And these guys started to prophesy. These guys started to talk about God's plan for the people. And they shared that all over the camp, and the folks inside the tent went, "Gasp! We can't do that." They hadn't been to the ceremony. They hadn't been in the tent with the 70 elders. Who did they think they were, anyhow? And Moses' right-hand man, Joshua, who should have known better, comes running up and says, "My Lord, Moses, stop them." In other words, they haven't had the same experience with the Spirit that we've had. And Moses' answer was simple. He said, "Let them be. I wish God would give a gift of the Spirit to everyone in the camp." The gift of God's Spirit should never be used as a tool to divide us or separate us. There's too much division and separation going on in the world today already. Instead, that Spirit should bring us together. The story of the Pentecost gift in Acts says the same thing. Everyone who heard the good news in his or her language heard the same message being proclaimed. Salvation is found in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. How many different ways can this church and its members, whether you're young or old, whether you're new to the congregation or long-term members, how many different ways can we share that message? Engineers should be able to talk to other engineers in ways that only an engineer can understand about the love of Jesus. Teachers should be able to use their skills and their contacts to live that love in the classroom. Our caregivers, each with a healing touch, should be communicating the love of Jesus. Our young people, with their wide variety of skills and interests, can and should be developing a message of faith in Jesus for their friends and their classmates to see and hear. There are no limits to the possibilities. And that's the exciting thing about being part of this body of faith called the church, the body of Christ. The need to hear that good news is tremendous. There's no lack of opportunity for us out there to share that good news with others. The voices might be different, but the message is the same. The way we share that good news might be different, but the message is the same. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. The truth of Pentecost is that we've already been given an unlimited resource of God's Spirit. Now go. Get out of here. Tell someone else, what you know. And share that good news with joy. Amen. Amen. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, as we come. come to the well of your goodness and grace. And we lower our buckets, they always come back full because there's more than enough to supply the world, and you're eager to share that good news with us and through us. May we share a refreshing message to a thirsty world of your love and your grace and your compassion, that they might see the church as not an institution that divides and argues, but as a body of faith, living together, loving together, seeking to draw others to a saving knowledge of your love for us in Jesus Christ our Lord. May that be what we are about, and may that call be reinforced as we come now to your table to share the supper that you shared with your first disciples. And yes, Lord, even as they left that upper room invigorated, empowered, and filled with joy, may we leave this place this morning with that same sense of your Spirit empowering us to share the good news of Jesus in whatever way you call us.